All right, this is the April 10th meeting of the Conway Board of Selectmen. This meeting is being videotaped by Frontier Community Access Television. Is there anybody else recording the program? Yeah, thank you. All right, first item on the agenda, the minutes for April the 3rd. Everybody gone over the minutes?
Okay, they look fine.
Yep. Gonna make a motion?
Make a motion, we accept the minutes.
Second.
All in favor?
Aye.
I can't vote because I wasn't here.
That's why the minutes were so good.
Okay. All right, next item on the agenda, meetings attended by select board members since last week. Any meeting?
I had two meetings last week. One was, I met with the housing committee, and they're still talking about locating the senior housing now behind the grammar school. And we talked about that, and they're having difficulty getting the grammar school to respond to their requests to have them come to the housing committee meetings or meet with them. So we talked to them about talking, they should go directly to the principal or something, but they're frustrated.
How many times they contact?
A number, quite a number.
And who are they contacting?
The chair.
Chair of the school committee?
Of the school committee, yeah.
Which is who?
Elaine Campbell.
And she's not getting back?
Right. So I think Pixie is gonna contact the principal and to get invited, you know, directly to a school committee meeting to come to the chair and talk to them there. There really shouldn't be any issue, it's just that they want to talk to the school to make sure the school doesn't have an issue.
Right, because it's town property.
Right.
So, okay.
And on Thursday, we had an FCAT meeting, an FCAT board meeting. And the marginally exciting thing that's going on there is FCAT is in the process of moving from South Deerfield down to Sunderland. So our next FCAT meeting might actually be in our new dig down in Sunderland. And we're moving to some open space in the Sunderland Town Hall. It won't cost us anything. And it'll have heat, which will be nice. The building we're current in has no heat. And the only disadvantage is it's not in the middle of Deerfield, and it's not quite as close to Frontier, which we like for the relationship to the students at Frontier.
Right.
But
Okay.
Those are the two meetings.
Okay. I attended the opening of the new Justice Center, Franklin County. That's the new courthouse. That was Friday afternoon. Lieutenant Governor was there, Senator Rosenberg, Steve Kulik, Mayor Martin, and a bunch of other dignitaries. It was a warm event. I didn't bother going to on tour to the courthouse. Getting a little late on Friday afternoon. Okay.
I bet this afternoon we did meet something. Well, to look over the work going on upstairs. There was a question about that space between the beams and the outside walls. And the reformer wasn't there, but the guy that's in charge of the workers was there. He said that he talked to his boss about it. He said before the project's done, that will all be sealed.
Good.
Otherwise, it looks like he's doing a really good job there.
Good, okay, that's great.
And tomorrow, as Tom's probably gonna mention, this building's gonna be closed tomorrow because they're gonna put, be spraying the attic with urethane foam spray. So nobody can enter the building.
Good. All right, do we have any citizens' concerns? Hearing none, we'll go on to old business. Old business, we have community action report on the public-private weatherization program.
This is Peter Wingate.
I know. How are you doing, Peter?
Each other.
Good. Thank you.
Bob Baker.
Peter.
Anderson.
Armstrong.
Armstrong, sorry.
Everybody does that.
I have trouble with emails too, if you get the wrong ones.
There is a Bob Anderson here in town.
Yes, there is. Anyway, and this is Peter Wingate, who's been our partner now for 3 years, to the tune of $90,000, and we've contributed $90,000, and it's wrapping up with some good data, and just in time for cutbacks, right? Here too. So.
Well, we'll see. There's still money. Not your money. We've spent your money, but we still have other money for other people in the town of Conway who have not yet taken advantage of the services. And if I could, I wrote a short letter to you. I'd sure. love to read this out loud.
Absolutely.
This will not be a theatrical reading, so apologies for that.
You are on camera, but...
Okay. This could be it. All right, to the Conway Selectboard. On behalf of the energy programs at Community Action of the Franklin, Hampshire, and North Quabbin regions, I'd like to thank the Select Board, Town Administrator, and especially Sue Bridge. This collaboration we established brought a greater degree of energy affordability and home safety to many residents of Conway. It was our pleasure to combine the funds from Conway, along with federal and utility-sponsored energy funds, to provide deeper energy savings to participating Conway residents. This was a forward-looking approach to energy efficiency, and I commend the Select Board for taking this action. Community Action continues to serve Conway, and we encourage residents to contact us directly about ongoing programs. Please contact our Client Services Coordinator, Remy Miller, at 413-376-1140 or by email at energyprog@communityaction.us. So to the Select Board, Town Administrator Sue, and all the residents of the town of Conway, thank you. It was a resounding well done.
Thank you.
So just going to give you a real quick smattering of some of the things we did. I'm going to prepare a bigger report that kind of outlines it. I'm hoping to even take a few minutes and try to put some calculated energy savings, because I think that's kind of cool myself. But for this final third year of the 3 years, we were able to help an additional 8 households, and the funds that you have put in also leveraged about another $16,000 worth of funding that we had on our part, to again really provide measures that would not have been done through the normal Mass Save program, through the normal Community Action program. We're able to go deeper, get better energy savings, giving people some measures such as ductless mini splits, higher performing windows, yet better heating systems than we would otherwise be able to afford, and appliances such as Energy Star refrigerators. So again, in my opinion, it was a great program. It's something that I've used when I've talked to other communities. When other communities have called me and said, what can Community Action do for them? I have said, well, we can do a lot for you, but let me tell you about a community that helped themselves as well. So thank you for giving me the opportunity to bring that up with other towns.
Great. Thank you, Peter. Appreciate that. Any questions for Peter?
I just want to say, you know, I've talked to a lot of people in town who have used your program or the Mass Save program, and frankly, it's hard for me to ever know which one people are participating in, and every response is excellent.
That's good.
That people just rave about, you know, the way the workers show up and approach their house, and being polite and informative, and you know, looking around their house and finding excellent ways of improving it.
And again, I can't stress enough, if you weren't one of the families that were included with the Community Action Program the last 3 years, we still have federal funding, we still have utility funding. Give us a call and we'll find something for you.
Great.
How many towns overall, over the 3 years, how many households?
I'm going to give you the exact number. I could estimate a number now, somewhere between 25 and 30, but I'll get you the exact number. And get some interesting information. Not going to share anybody's name, of course, because I think we all agreed that privacy was a good thing. But we have some numbers on how many kids under age 10, how many elders were served, some things like that I think is kind of neat to look at.
Good.
So I'll get you that within the next couple of weeks.
Thanks.
Appreciate you very much.
Thanks, Peter.
The most wonderful calculation is the energy savings for these houses. I mean, people going forward will have to spend much less.
Well, that's good.
On there, yeah. I mean, that's a hugely meaningful in a way.
Yeah. Very good, sure. That's your best dollar is your conservation dollar.
That's right, the dollar you never spend.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Okay. Thank you for coming in.
Thank you.
Appreciate it.
I'm going to give you the letter if that's all right. And since I still got just a bit of the camera, I do want to thank Sue yet once again. Sue is a force of nature. when I first met her 3 years ago, she's one of the people I realized I should say yes to, because saying no would have just been a waste of time.
We say yes to Sue.
Thanks.
Thank you all very much.
Thank you. Good night. Good night, Sue. Good night.
I'm actually very mild.
All right, next item on the agenda is going to be to appoint Jake Purinton to labor position, starting salary of $15 an hour. Jake, how are you doing?
Good, yourself?
Good. Ron, do you have anything for us?
Well, we went back through the application process again, and actually this time I think we came up with a really good candidate, and I'm proud that he's coming on board. You guys make the appointment.
Great. Do you have any questions for us, Jay?
Not this time, no.
All set.
Dan, you've got some other highway experience?
Yeah, I do. Town of Buckland. I plowed snow for him this past winter.
Well, we could have used you.
I could have gone over the line in Conway. We wouldn't have said nothing.
Yeah. Do you ever do any repairs on the road in northern Conway, Buckland?
Yeah.
The potholes that my car falls into.
Oh, yeah. Yeah. Some of them are pretty bad. Yeah, no, I mean, as far as town experience, I mean, they had a winter opening for plowing snow. Kind of got my foot in the door there. And they didn't really have any openings, and I saw Conway was looking for something, so why not try and apply? And
do you have hydraulic license?
I do.
Good, that's great.
Where do you live? Do you have to drive far?
Shelburne Falls.
Oh, that's great. So,
in the process of getting my CDL right now, I got my permit. I just finished nets. Testing within the next 2 weeks.
Great. Yeah, terrific. Okay. Anything else for Jay?
They recommend him.
Based on the recommendation of our highway super, I will move that we appoint Jake Purinton to the labor position on the highway department. Do I have a second?
Second.
All in favor?
Aye.
Welcome aboard, Jay.
Thank you.
Are you a Purinton of all the local Purintons?
Yeah.
A lot of furry things there.
The plumbers.
Okay.
Welcome.
Welcome to town, Jake.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you. See you soon.
Yep.
Enjoy the rest of your night.
Okay. Okay, we don't have the superintendent here from the chair of the trust from Smith Vocational, so I guess we'll wait for them. And we don't have the finance committee here either. Okay. I'm going to skip down to items not anticipated 48 hours in advance of the meeting. The council for the United Congregational Church wants to meet with us and the town council. So we're looking at a date, either the 19th or the 20th. Everybody check their calendars on those dates.
April 19th and 20th?
April 19th and 20th.
Either day in front of me.
What time?
We'll probably make it 7 o'clock, 6 o'clock, whenever.
So I'd probably prefer the 20th if it's possible, but I can...
I would prefer the 20th as well.
Me too.
Okay. All right. So we'll make it the 20th in the evening.
6 p.m.? All
right. 6, 7? We'll pencil in. What do we want? We don't...
We might as well say 6.
We'll say 6. Right. We'll go for 6 on the 20th.
Yeah, that'll be in town office?
Yeah, that should be good.
I was just checking to see whether our visitors from Smith Vogue might have been trying to get in over there. We do have a sign up over there to come over here, so.
Okay. Let's skip down to your update.
All right. Have a Freudian slip for, there we go. This will be short. A little Freudian slip in the first sentence. It should say that work is progressing on insulating upstairs. As Bob mentioned, Town Hall will have to be closed tomorrow. We've made arrangements with the assessors and groups that were slated, not salted in need. I was doing it at the last minute. For departmental updates, summer hours for the highway department are starting this week. The town report is set to go to the printer tomorrow, along with the warrant. There will be two inserts, one explaining about the changes in Article 2, and one on the wastewater proposal. Also, the United States flag at the Veterans Memorial was in particularly bad shape. I've temporarily fixed it and have ordered a new one. And finally, on town meeting news, pre-town meeting will be Monday, May 1st, 7 to 8:30 p.m. Here are flyers for that. If you want to put them up anywhere, please put them up. I'm sure there will be more people putting them up around town as well, but...
And that'll be on our Facebook page?
You know, it's interesting. The town of Conway has a Facebook page. I have no idea how to access the administrative site on that. Hmm. It was set up a long time ago, and... But we'll certainly have it on our website. So that is... my update for now.
Okay. All right, next item on our agenda is Kevin Farr and Michael Cahillane.
Cahillane.
Gentlemen.
Good evening. My name is Mike Cahillane. I am chairman of the Board of Trustees at Smith Vocational Agricultural High School. And one of the things that we want to do this year is to have an opportunity to come out and visit the communities that send their children to us. So we have been, I call it the listening tour, because we want to listen to anything that you may have that you'd like to discuss with us. And we have been to many of the communities and have been warmly received and wanted to take the time off our schedule and respect your time to give us some time on the agenda to come and talk about our school. I went to the school, graduated in 1964. I see I drove out the driveway but never left. I have been involved in an advisory capacity for the whole term, and then one of our trustees passed away, David Bourbeau, and the city council and the school asked me to run for that position to fulfill his term. So I did that, and then when that was done, they asked me to run for the seat. So it was kind of interesting. You of political background would know that when I went to run for the position, his name was still on there because he had passed away, but his name was still on the ballot. So I had to run on stickers, so that was that. But because of the Cahillane name in Northampton, my dad was the first three-term mayor of the city of Northampton. And so as they say, I had roots and had an opportunity to get elected, and now I'm working on my fourth two-year term. And it's been an honor for me to be able to represent the school and to put together some things that are very exciting in regards to growing the school. We have approximately 500 students, and I'll let my interim superintendent, Kevin Farr, talk about that. Kevin.
Thank you, Michael. And Michael introduced me as the interim superintendent because I am officially retired. I was a superintendent of the Upper Cape Cod Regional Technical School down in Bourne. I spent my entire 33-year teaching career as a kid who grew up in the city of Worcester and found his way down in the Cape. And I had been a superintendent for Connecticut in 4 years, and I saw this posting, and I thought that, like Mike, I get back to my roots, and I go back into career and technical education. And so this is my first foray into agricultural education as well. So one of the things that I noticed when I first came in last August was that we needed to accentuate the agricultural education that we offer at our school. So we're expanding the animal science, the agricultural mechanics. You have one student from in our school for agricultural mechanics. Previous administration had expanded some of their technical offerings on the Chapter 74 side and offered criminal justice. So we also have a student from your town in criminal justice as well. And obviously those would be technical areas that were not offered in Franklin County Tech. And of course, being in the Mass Association of Vocational Administrators for many years, I have great relationships with vocational administrators, with Rick Martin at Franklin County Tech, and with our all of our sending communities. And I try to work with our sending communities, with Frontier and so forth. And we have with us here, I believe she's the chair of the Frontier Regional, and she's also a cosmetology teacher at Smith Vocational Agricultural. So I get to see her every single day, and that's a good thing as well. And we're very proud of how the school has evolved and how it will evolve as I get ready to, we're in the middle of a search for a full-time permanent superintendent, and I will help them through that process and then step back into my next role, whatever that may be. Hopefully it'll be working with kids someplace. One of the things that we've done in addition is we like to explain how the school is governed. It's basically another department in the city of Northampton. So the students from Northampton, there's about 100 of them that come to the school, and that gets paid for through Chapter 70, just like you pay your Chapter 70 money to whatever schools your kids go to. The rest of our students, the other 400 from all over the four counties, and I've got kids from Worcester County as well as Berkshire County, Franklin, Hampden, Hampshire, that's done on a tuition basis. A year ago, the tuition was increased because there was a waiver that was filed by the previous administration to keep that tuition at $17,000 per child. And this year, we decided, because our numbers of students that are accessing this type of education has increased, we decided to let the state does set that tuition rate. So this year, it's $16,728, so it did come down slightly, and we did not file a waiver to artificially increase that. As a superintendent in rural Connecticut and also down the Cape, I had five towns down there that I had to serve in technical education, and I totally understood where they were coming from their budgets and how they tried to make it all work, because you have a lot to do. And I certainly am very active in the town that I live in back there, and I've now become very active up here, because it's like when you come to a new place, you tend to own that, and you're very fortunate. This is a wonderful area, and the kids up here, they're great kids. And I was a principal and an assistant principal, so I've seen the gamut of what it takes to run a school and a school system. And the kids up here are hardworking kids all in all. And we see a bright future for Smith Vocational Agricultural High School. And our budget is in. It's into the city of Northampton for their consideration. And I think this is the first year in many years that we've actually convinced the city to spend some money on the infrastructure at Smith Vocational, because where they only send 20% of the students, they may not see a value in contributing to the infrastructure, but they are going to replace a freezer and a walk-in in the cafeteria, which also serves as the shelter in case of emergencies for the city, and also some upgraded door locks for the school as well. So that's courtesy of the city of Northampton. I will tell you that we don't know from year to year where the kids are going to come from or who's going to be interested in agricultural education, but our plan is to expand those offerings, because it seems to me that agriculture is alive and well in Western Mass. And I was in Boston today lobbying on your behalf out here, on behalf of career technical and agricultural education. with Senator Diaz. She's trying to get more money for Chapter 70. And so I was standing there representing that group of administrators, vocational administrators, and hopefully we'll help you out in that regard. Anything I've forgotten?
No, what I want to add is that through the agricultural side, which is, we're the only school west of 495 that has a working farm. So I'd like to invite you down anytime if you're in the area. Please come and visit the opportunity and see our cows and pigs and goats and sheep and the children take to these tasks of taking care of these animals. It's unbelievable, the bond that is formed. And they've won all kinds of awards. Our FFA department just came back from Sturbridge and they got all kinds of awards there. We have our student body where we have just put together, the superintendent and I went over to Stockbridge. We have bonded and put together a feeder program to be able to have our students come right out of the Smith Vocational if they choose and go right into Stockbridge. So they have an opportunity there. So we have other students that are, we're a level one school, which means on the MCAS, that our students for an agricultural school to do level one is pretty awesome.
They know because their elementary school is as well.
There you go. So, absolutely. So we all have a lot to be proud of there. And then we have some of our students that are coming out of a skill level class that can either go into a trade or can go on to college. And we have quite a few of our students that are going on to colleges, two-year and four-year, from the Elms and Chicopee, right up through Holyoke and Greenfield, and different schools that are the opportunity, as well as going out to Lincoln Tech and taking technical schools. So we really, I myself as a past graduate, am very proud of the school. The other two trustees are Tom Fitzgerald, who went to the school, and Jack Cotton, who was a teacher at the school. So we have a five-member board. Three of us are elected, and the other one is the mayor and the Northampton School Superintendent, John Provost. So it's a good group of folks that follow up and make sure that the school runs on a regular basis. What I want to do is I'll leave you my business card tonight. And please feel free at any time to call me if there's a question. Mm-hmm. And of course, you can send me here personally. So that, sure. Yeah, but questions.
How are you finding enrollment?
We're doing very well. And I can say that because I just heard the gentleman talk about a website and about a web page and all that. Through our high tech department of doing this type of work, our IT guy built a website and built a page and a Facebook and a Twitter and yada, 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 stuff that I'm not using, but everybody else is, in regards to promote the school. And it has worked. And I got to tell you, we're getting phone calls from up and down the valley that want to go to Smith School. So it is not your grandfather's Smith School, as you would say. It's high tech. It's people that are really interested. And the thing is that I came out of the collision repair industry, and I did body work, and I built kaolin out of body Northampton towing and all that. So I had, you know, grease under my fingernails and things like that, but there weren't too many young kids that wanted to get up in their mother's lap and said, I want to be a body man. Mm-hmm. So it was a real challenge to find good people to work on cars. And today with computerization, you would think that would be a different way for them to go in a cleaner environment. But we just put 11 students in our collision repair technology department that people want to work on cars and do want to paint them, do want to fix them. And they do realize that the computerization in the automobile is the same as a 747. So that's high tech too. So there's a lot to it, and we're just down the road. So like I said, thank you for sending your students, and please feel free to call us at any time.
Last year was about 468. And this current year, we're about 486, and we project just shy of 500 next year.
Okay. And what curriculum do most of them want to go into?
It runs the gamut from animal science, agricultural mechanics, landscape horticulture, to, as Mike said, auto collision repair, because they're an award-winning group. in Skills USA. Our criminal justice program is very, very popular. There was actually a waiting list for freshmen to go into that program. We've got a young lady that's a former detective in, I believe she was from Munson, and she's one of our teachers. Another young man who retired from the Air Force, he was Air Police and K-9 in the Air Force, and he's one of the other teachers. And they're all getting licensed under Chapter 74 through the Commonwealth to be able to teach those programs. And, you know, our typical programs of cosmetology, culinary arts are still very popular, as I'm sure they are at Franklin Tech as well. Sure. You know.
And the governor gave us a check for $400,000 to build up our mechanical department, our machinist.
Manufacturing technology and electrical.
In our electrical department. So we're reinvesting that to have the best. And we have an advisory board of business owners that know what they want their students coming out to have for knowledge to come in and go to work for them. So we're putting that all together so it all meshes.
I'm also working with the state to try to work out a way to help to make sure you get reimbursed for transportation. Because that's where it really, really hurts the towns.
That would be outstanding, yeah. Because that's where a lot of our costs
are. Well, the law is there, they just don't fund it.
Yes.
You know? Right. So, we just leave these here.
Do you have a good number under your electrical trade down there?
We do.
Yeah, because
I've got them working on campus. We're doing some renovation on campus, and we're saving the taxpayers a lot of money because the students and the teachers are doing the work.
I graduated from Smith and Lofton in 1968.
There you go.
When you come down to campus, I'll say this like I say to all of them, welcome home. In
76, I was asked to teach at vocational school. We owned it at Franklin Tech.
Yeah.
For 10 years, I taught the Lofton trade there. Yeah. We were at our refresher conference this weekend. Was for a license refreshing, and they were saying, the state people were telling us that the trade, young people, the trade from way down.
Yeah. Well, we're trying to get them out there because the folks down in Springfield are calling for trades folks, you know.
That's a nice thing to hear.
We have an adult and continuing ed program now, and we're doing code classes at night for electrical and plumbing.
Good.
And we believe we're pretty close with the state to being able to offer a full electrician's course at night. Like you say, you graduate from high school, you decide you want to become an electrician, you can come to Smith School at night and learn to be an electrician in 2 years.
And we're bringing back an LPN program, licensed prep for nursing, that was there at the school 30 years ago. We're putting a building all together now, Greenfield Community College will be running.
Great.
Do you have any programs where you if a town needed a project done, you would do that. Could you send some information on that?
I sure can.
That'd be great.
We in my former life, my kids always were out in the community doing work, whether it's Habitat for Humanity, which we're doing right now at Amherst, or whether it's working on our own campus so we could enhance and repair our own campus without asking for more resources from the taxpayers. And the legacy that I left when I retired was I left them in the hands of the next superintendent, who happened to be my principal at the time, and he's continuing that legacy back there. And that was the legacy I brought to Smith, was to be able to put all hands on deck. These kids are learning how to be tradespeople. Their teachers are their foremen, and let's work on something that will live on for years to come. You come back to school like you did, you say, I worked on that, I built that room. So we've done lots of different things in my career. I've done gazebos and bridges and different things for different towns over the years. If you go to the old Silver Beach in Falmouth and use the restrooms, my kids built those.
That's great.
Thank you, Kevin. Thank you, Michael.
Pleasure. I
appreciate you coming in very much.
So it's still no good for you, Joe, are you?
They can go with the town board.
We'll get another one.
All right, next item on the agenda is a joint meeting with the Finance Committee and Capital Improvements Planning Committee.
Okay, let me get addressed to that committee.
Joe, come on up to the table with us.
No, I'm good for now. I don't want to be, you know, limelight too much. Yeah, bro, where is this thing?
Okay, you've got all your people?
No, we don't quite have a quorum, but I wouldn't let that hold things up.
Right, right.
Camera's rolling, so.
You have a quorum, right? Three is a quorum.
Three out of five?
No.
Three out of five?
Well, it's a six-member body.
Oh, it is? Oh, that's right.
Well, half. Half is good.
No, if you ask Ginny, four is a quorum for us, yeah.
Four is a quorum.
We struggle with that all the time. But let's get going.
All right, we have to review recommendations of the Highway Department request for a hydraulic boom. Do you guys have any comments on that?
Well, just that, you know, I think that when we met with you folks on the 28th, you know, Ron wasn't here, but Bob Baker came out with some fairly strong positioning about this article, and the Finance Committee revoted the recommendation that it had voted prior to that meeting, which was originally it was to recommend the article. On the 28th, we voted to make no recommendation, not to. We didn't give it a thumbs down, we just said we'd let town meeting review it. But I guess, you know, at that meeting, really, Ron wasn't here to make a case for that. And the only the Capital Improvement Planning Committee had actually heard the presentation. And in talking with Tom, it seemed, and John, it seemed that it made sense for us to, you know, give him an opportunity to tell us about that and make a case for it. Maybe we would, you know.
Yeah. Okay, so Ron, do you want to give us a rundown on that?
Yep. All right, well, what I'm looking for is a used piece of equipment. It's a hydraulic boom lift. It's to help us with our safety issues with tree trimming mainly, for a lot of other areas that it would be used in, including building maintenance. I know that there was a huge issue with liability that got brought up, and it's really not any different than any other piece of equipment that the highway department operates. I mean, every one of them is a liability issue if you want to look at it from that point of view, but this piece of equipment, we would have trained operators using it. There's no, as far as I know, there's no additional insurance that would be needed for this piece of equipment. We already have all the insurance that covers all of our equipment that we use. It covers all of our operations. And when I went through the Capital Improvement Committee in the beginning, I had a unanimous vote to them to recommend it, which is why it got moved forward. So, and then one of the members from that committee is on the Finance Committee, and one is on the Board of Selectmen. So when this issue came up at the Selectmen's meeting, it kind of surprised me that neither of them spoke to what the meeting was that we had with the committee. And so I'm trying to bring this.
So this piece of equipment, how do we handle what this piece of equipment would do now? How do we handle that now?
A lot of dangerous situations, like pole saw, doing a lot of the work with pole saws. sometimes even in the back of a truck, trying to reach what we need to reach. A lot, if it's something that we can't do with that, we end up hiring a tree company to come in to take care of, and that's time-consuming and expensive.
What's the cost difference?
Tree company, we're probably looking at, I think, around $1,200 a day for a company to come in. Generally, it's hard to find a company to come in for one day. And a lot of times, it's difficult to get them on short notice for something that we need. Rental of a machine, looked into that, but by the time you get done with transporting it back and forth from wherever you're renting it from, you've already eaten up half a day. So if you're renting it by the day, you end up with only a couple hours of use out of it. That's why I went with a used piece of equipment. It's something that we will use a lot, but not, I don't know how to explain. We'll use it a lot, but it won't be used all the time, I guess. I'm not quite sure how to, you know, because there'll be times where we need it for 10, 15 minutes. Mm-hmm. And them instances makes it where it's worth it for us to own one over renting or hiring out somebody capable of doing the work.
How many hours a year do you figure you use this?
Well, right now, when we do tree trimming now, we're probably spending somewhere in the 3 to 4 week range of time spent. A lot of it, we can't do what we really want to do for the tree trimming because we can't reach what we need to reach. So 3 to 4 weeks a year pretty regularly on a normal basis, and then whatever use that we would have for other, you know, emergencies and things like that.
Questions for Ron?
I mean, my original question that I had when we talked before, it's a used piece of equipment, and you talk about that people are going to get trained. Usually when you buy a new piece of equipment, those people will train your help. Who's going to train these people?
There's courses available for, like United Rentals offers classes that we can take. And, there's plenty of schooling out there. OSHA, they all have to be OSHA certified. That's, you can do that part of it online, but
correct.
The United Rentals is one company that offers actual training.
Have you talked to your employees to ask who really wants to use this piece of equipment?
Yes.
And they've all agreed that they'd love
to use it? No, they haven't all agreed. So it doesn't mean that all of them will be trained. They'll all be doing the OSHA so that when they're working around a piece of equipment, they understand what's going on. Doesn't mean that they'll actually be in that piece of equipment.
You said, no, not all employees. What do you mean by that?
No, we have an employee that's a little afraid, doesn't like heights. So,
one?
Yeah. This point.
I don't either.
I don't think I need to express my opinion on it because I did it before. I don't feel comfortable with this piece of equipment, and I never will. It just, to me, having a highway worker 30 feet up in the air, it just doesn't cut the mustard in the air. I'm going to stay that way.
Okay.
This reminds me a little bit of a courtroom. And the phrase that comes to mind is asked and answered. Our committee spent an evening reviewing this, got all this information that is now being brought out again, made a recommendation. So, and Ron was kind of frustrated at that meeting because, or actually it wasn't that meeting, it was when I met a second time with the board. He thought he was going through the same thing all over again. Now we're doing it a third time. If that's going to be the practice, we don't need a capital improvement committee. You could just keep rehashing this and rehashing it. You were there, Roy. I don't know why the finance committee decided to take no position on this. I think you guys need to either be for or against. You have a habit of having no position. And as a member of the town meeting, when I go in, I like to know who's for it and who's against it, and if they're against it, why, and if they're for it, why. No position doesn't tell me anything. So that's my two cents.
Go ahead, Gordon.
Dana, let me first respond. Many times when we would take no position, it's because we feel it's best discussed on the floor of the town meeting, and we want to encourage that discussion. So that's the first thing. The second thing I want to respond to is what happened for me personally, and I can only speak for me personally, is that when Bob Baker reminded, and I say reminded because the $20,000 to me was not an issue. It, from a value point of view, $20,000 is probably good value for that piece of equipment. But he reminded me about liability and how for years this committee and select board denied a wood chipper to the road crew for the same reasons. So I wanted to ask a silly question. Now, before I even ask the question, I did ask Tom earlier, a few days ago, if he would check and see what would happen with our workers' comp. That's really where I think the liability is in this thing. What would happen to our workers' comp rates when they see a description and we add now somebody working 30 feet above? It's one thing, I'm driving a truck, yes, we can do great damage, and they know they can factor all that stuff in, et cetera, et cetera. So Tom came back, he said, well, nothing's gonna happen to the current rate. They'll just expand the description. And I thought about it, and it's, well, this is probably true. And it's also true if somebody falls and is killed, because if you're up 30 feet and you fall, you're gone. You know.
Can I say something to that?
Well, let me finish, if it's okay. So the question I wanted to ask is, to me, it's similar. Would the town road crew be working on a roof of one of our buildings? Is that even in the bailiwick of things that the road crew would do?
It would fall under building maintenance.
The building maintenance now falls under the highway department.
Right.
So a building, any part of a building, the highway crew could be working on that particular thing.
Okay. Well,
you know, okay. This says in the, and I asked Tom to make the copies. This is your rules and regulations just for the fall. It says here that the construction of repair of equipment operators are responsible for the performance, skilled and unskilled manual and non-manual work in the maintenance, construction and repair of outdoor town property.
It is not an outdoor town building.
Then it says streets, sidewalks,
in parentheses.
What is this done?
That's your document, dear. Did you? It's a job description behind place.
But let me answer that before I forget. Being up 30 feet in the machine, you're required to be harnessed.
You're gonna be clipped in, yeah.
So you're not gonna fall to the ground.
Just like do machines fail? Does ground give way sometimes? And I mean, any kind of accident can happen with those machines.
Any kind of accident can happen with any kind of machine.
This is true.
You're saying is that you're just singling out a piece of equipment that could happen to any piece of equipment.
Well, keep in mind, it wasn't just this piece of equipment. We singled out a wood chipper in the past as well. Okay. And I suspect if you had come with a wood chipper, you would have got the same immediate response.
But there's no problem with the highway department renting a wood chipper now, right? Or never has been. It was the purchase thing that...
Again,
I think you're misconstruing what...
The $20,000 probably represents very good value, okay? But it's, as a finance committee, we tend to look beyond just that piece of thing, where I think, Dana, maybe this answers you, because at least sitting here, I would think the capital improvements committee could say, yes, this is good value. We're not looking beyond that. We leave it to the select board, maybe the finance committee.
We did feel it was good value.
Okay.
Good value monetarily, and I mean, Bob and I are kind of at odds on this. I think it's a lot safer than having somebody crawl up on the top of a cab protector on a dump truck to try and saw a limb down with a pole saw.
I don't think they should do that either.
It doesn't make sense.
But you're talking a little different there, Dan. Right, you're not, shouldn't be standing on a cab protector and pick up with a pole saw, number one. I agree with you, but they do.
Exactly.
But that doesn't reach no damn 30 feet in the air.
No. And as far as the wood chip was concerned, I can remember back when that issue was about. I had a wood chipper, and I wouldn't rent it to the town because it was the old style. It was called a chuck and duck. It grabbed a piece of wood, and it was gone on your jacket or something. You were gone with it. Well, times have changed, and they're completely different now. They're hydraulic feeds. You control the speed at which it goes in. I would have no problem with the town on a wood chipper.
Tom?
I'd say that this is a little different than I remember budget hearings from mid-90s to mid-00s. But so I myself never heard a presentation before. Different departments would come in. It was a little different now. So didn't really hear the presentation. But it was pretty much voted yes. But then Bob was pretty adamant. You know, just sitting here, you know, people don't run this stuff all the time. You know, I'm up 30 feet, but not usually when they're lifters.
Mm-hmm.
But, you know, Bob was adamant and was like, oh, that's not a bad point, I don't know. At a certain point, you're just volunteers. You know, so you can only make your what you know and your basis for deciding things. You can only take it so far, because you don't really know. I used to say to Joe at the old meetings, you know, we're talking about this heavy equipment, and I'd say, you know, no one in this room really knows anything about this heavy equipment. But there we were all deciding about it. Just to say that, you know, people do what they try to do what they can do. But it wasn't a vote against the equipment. It was more a response to Bob raising alarm bells, and it was legitimate.
So I guess the issue is one of liability for some kind of safety thing, but in terms of the financial impact of this on the town, I heard Roy express that was not a major issue for the finance committee.
The $20,000 expenditure? Mm-hmm. I don't think it is.
And we're recommended by capital improvements. Okay. So the only issue here is, do we have an increase in liability? Do we have an increase in liability?
The way it seems, no. I kind of find that a little hard to believe. But
we don't.
I don't think you have an increase in liability to the fact that you're going to charge the town more, like he just said.
Until
I think your common sense says, right, you've got a guy now that might be up 30 feet in the air. You've got to think about that.
Well, if a problem should happen, God forbid, then I assure you the rates will go up, because they don't pay out without collecting down the line. So, I mean, but that would be the case if somebody rolls a truck or whatever it is, you know, they're getting it back in subsequent years.
Ron, do you think there's a big increase in the unsafety of this piece of equipment?
I think it's a huge safety gain for the highway department in the way we've been doing tree trimming mainly. Because when you're standing underneath a branch with a 13-foot pole saw and the branch is coming down at you, and that's the thought.
Well, isn't that kind of though, what the highway crew's been doing is kind of the prohibitive, an example of the prohibitive sign? I mean, not to say, well, they're trying to get it, so you do what you can. You're saying, so this is a lot safer.
Yeah,
I'm a little wondering about the mission creep, you know. Things just get bigger and bigger and bigger. You know, the highway department, the buildings, and I just wonder about that aspect of things. And not just the highway department, across the board, the whole town, committees all over the place. There's suggestions and stuff flying everywhere.
The world is changing so fast, with safety being an issue. There's so many things now that
you can't really do because of safety. You have an employee, and all he's got to do is say, "I'm afraid." And it doesn't matter whether you're doing everything in your power to make it safe for him. If he feels he's in jeopardy, then you can't make him do that job. So basically, we have to be proactive in safety in everything we do.
So at the interview, you got to scare him to see?
Yeah, well, that's a different... Interviews are different. I mean, what you can say and things like that. So it's a very difficult situation.
Well, I understand the craziness. You know, all we're doing here is seeing that this is already a warrant article. Okay. See if the town wants to vote for this or not.
Right.
Okay. So what does finance say?
Well, it's tough because we don't have a quorum, unfortunately. And I just, oh, wait a minute. Oh, we have a quorum. How about that? Come on, Bob, get in here.
Yeah, you'll see some.
Can we stall the discussion?
Quick, go tell them about the chipper. What's the thing? Lift.
Joe, do you have something?
I was just going to, my name is Joe Martari, and I'm with FERCOG, and I'll be talking to you about long-range planning. But I've been doing capital plans for a lot of the towns around. I've done at least a half a dozen of them. And many of them do have bucket trucks, and many of them do have wood chippers. And if you're concerned, you may just ask those highway guys or DPW guys what their experience is with it, if you have concerns over it. But I'm coming from the eastern part of the state, and everybody's got a bucket truck, primarily because more and more towns are buying their light poles and lights. And it's a safety issue. It's rather than getting the ladder and going up, they get into the bucket. It's considered an improvement. But as I say, there's a lot of towns that have those pieces of equipment, and you might want to just ask what their experience has been.
Well, that's kind of where this came from for me, was because that was the initial thought was a bucket truck. But the limits in a bucket truck over, I've used the boom lifts before, and they're so much more versatile, and it puts two men up where you're working, so when you're doing branches and stuff like that, you have the ability of a person being able to keep, you know, control the branch.
How many communities around us have a hydrogen instead of a bucket truck?
Nobody that I know of. But what's the difference?
I'm just saying,
30 feet in a bucket truck is...
If that's such a much better deal, then why aren't the towns going to?
It's more money though.
If you bought a new one, you're talking probably $150,000 for one. So, and I'm not opposed to used equipment to make. Well, if it means that I can end up with a safer way, what's that?
West Hampton.
Yes, it's been awesome.
Is that why our budget's gone up quite a bit in the highway department for used maintenance this year?
That's because of a greater than the transmission.
That we were told that was going to come out of this year's budget.
All right, let's stay on point. We're talking about this boom. All right. What's the finance committee saying?
So we just gained quorum. Unfortunately, Bob, I don't know if you are interested in. We're looking to have a motion here to see if the finance committee would recommend or on this article again. So for the lift. All right.
Okay, I make a motion.
So, all right, I second. What's the motion? Is the motion to recommend it?
But recommend it or not?
Do you want to bring him up to speed on this?
I don't know how I can. I mean,
are we talking about here, Zach?
Let me try and bring up the speed.
$20,000.
It's $20,000. Everybody agrees it's good value per se. The question, at least on the finance committee, has been one of, do we want to expose the town to potential liability should the worst case situation happen where one or two guys fall off the thing or the equipment fails and they're either crippled for life or they're dead. Yeah. So, I mean, that to me is what we're talking about. If it was a wood chip, right, say, we're talking about loss of limb, you know, potentially, you know, I mean, so, and I just reminded people today that consistently, year after year, we denied a wood chipper for the very same reasons. That's all. nothing else.
And so, Ron, you wanted to speak to, you had spoken to those points before, so to let Bob know what you're...
I'm pretty up to speed on that. My feeling is, at this point, I'll have to agree with Bob here, if the other towns don't have it, why do we need it? And would it be cheaper if, you know, if you need something like that to rent?
We're spending a lot on this, we've already just went through this whole thing, and no, it's not cheaper to rent it, and it's not available when we need it. And yes, it's a boom lift, it's different than what other towns are using, it's the same thing as, it'd be used the same way as a bucket truck would be used.
And you just said you were going to use it 4 to 5 weeks a year. I understand you want it available whenever you rent might need it, but the actual use of it, you said, was between 4 to 5 weeks a year.
3 to 4 weeks is what I said.
But that's total over the whole year.
Yes.
Right, I mean, it's not...
And it's, like I said, when we're doing our tree trimming, we might do for 2 days here. Weather dependent is everything with tree trimming. Winter time, we try to do it as much as we can in the winter time.
How many towns have bucket trucks?
I know Deerfield and Sunderland and Waitley share one. Corrine just bought one. I know Montague, Greenfield, they all have.
I mean, to me, the question is how many towns have this particular piece of equipment, but how many people need this capability? And it sounds like they all do.
We all need the capability. Yeah. It all comes back to the safety factor. You know, doing things in a safe way without, I mean, you're worried about people getting hurt, and we're standing there with a chainsaw that's 13 feet up in the air. I just don't understand how you think that that's different than being up a bucket truck with a small chainsaw.
All right, Ron, your opinion is it's safer to have this piece of equipment?
Yes.
Okay. Do you guys want to change your recommendation?
I'd like to make a motion to the Finance Committee to recommend the article with a thumbs up, as opposed to what we did last time.
Okay, what's the vote?
Is there a second on that?
Well, you got a second or first, John?
All right, you're going to second it.
I already did.
Okay.
All in favor?
Aye.
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 Nay.
Okay. Oh, so we're split.
There you go. It's an aye vote.
2-2.
So you got a 2-2 vote?
Okay.
All right, I'll make a motion that the board recommend the article. Do I have a second?
Second.
All in favor?
Aye.
All opposed?
Aye.
2-1.
Okay.
Thank you.
Okay, next item, waste water. We have
after hearing this discussion, I don't have a chance.
We have the head sewer rat here.
Okay, so I'm guessing the 04 vote that I saw last Wednesday, and I apologize for my voice, means you don't see any economic value in the sewage treatment plants. I don't know how I'm going to handle that. I would love to have a no recommendation instead of a 04 recommendation. So to go back, I happened to see the warrant on Wednesday. We were having a wastewater meeting. And without any prior notice, I found out by looking at the warrant that it was a 04 recommendation. I had asked Tom if there was going to be a recommendation a couple weeks ago, and also I asked if there was going to be one from capital planning.
Well, there's a change.
Right. I understand that. So I guess I'm asking for a reconsideration in light of that. You know, Ashfield polluted Ashfield Lake. The state came in, they ended up spending $6 to $8 million. If we include our groundwater, the state comes in. I think it's a matter of time. If you talk to Glenn Ayers, for instance, at the COG, it's very hard to predict in ledge and rock, you know, when contamination and cross-contamination will occur. On the Cape, it's a lot easier. It's all sand. You put something in the ground here, it shows up in the water supply next door. It's pretty predictable. It's very hard to do in ledge and rock. I can't tell you when and if we're going to contaminate our groundwater.
but we've had a number of failed septic systems. Some have been put in 3 and 4 times in the center of town. They're getting more and more expensive. I've heard numbers from $15,000 to $65,000 for replacement systems. Some people are on their second or third one. If we pollute our groundwater, and we need a water supply and a sewage treatment plant, I think all bets are off. It's going to become harder and harder to sell houses in the center of town if people realize there's a septic problem in the center of town. It's going to happen. You know, it's sort of like the oil guy, pay me now or pay me later, I think, to a certain degree. I don't know what else I can tell you, but I was shocked to find that you don't see value in a sewage treatment plant and that you had a 0-4 recommendation. And it was even upsetting that it didn't get discussed. We never had an opportunity to even defend ourselves. So here I am.
And I'd also like to note, I have not yet included a capital improvements planning committee recommendation in the warrant because the original recommendation was for a proposal which is no longer on the warrant. The warrant article is now completely borrowing the money, with no money coming from capital stabilization or anything else. So if the Capital Improvement Planning Committee would also like to make a recommendation, that would be fine too. Right now there is no line for that in this under this article.
It seems to me that this is a setup for failure. We've got a 0-4 vote, we've got to go to town meeting, get a 2/3 vote to borrow the money, and then we have to have a ballot vote. It seems like an impossible task to me. Seems like it's a foregone conclusion. So I'm looking for some.
Let me make clear for one thing that technically we voted to not recommend at this time. And what we meant by that was that the straits that the town is in are such that $130,000, whether debt or purchased or whatever, seemed perhaps something that it was not dismissing the work or the proposal or even the need for it, but that's how we actually voted. It wasn't just like a 0-4. No, it's no good. It was not.
That's what's in print.
Well, I don't know how to.
That's, you'll need to express that at town meeting. Then if the vote doesn't change.
But
it's just something to
Joe,
explain.
How many people in the last couple of years have replaced this system? Say the last 5, how many new systems?
Probably 3 or 4.
How much it cost them?
I don't have specific numbers.
When you talk to those folks, were they interested in phoning up more money?
Probably not.
I think some of you know that, didn't they? Probably. I think you told me. One of them said, "Fine, they spend me $40. What are they doing? Crazy?"
It's not an easy situation.
Right.
The town's going to have to come together. The taxpayers are going to have to ante up some, and
they're going to be up big initially.
What's that?
They'll ante up big initially. That's always the whole is going to pay for it. That's how it works. And the people using it are going to be paying the cost to run it.
Tom's saying we might be able to qualify for a MassWorks grant in a year or two. I know that Bob's looking for some MassWorks money. So I can't give you a clear answer on whether we're going to get any funding. All of the sewer funding disappeared many years ago. Some people say it happened with Reagan. I don't know if that's true or not.
Forty years ago,
there was a lot of money for sewer systems when the Clean Water Act went in, and the town decided against it at that time.
Huh?
And so now the money is gone. It's much tougher. MassWorks is one option. There's a lot of low interest loans, but there's no grant that I can identify at this point.
Right. You're still talking only 30 people.
30 to start with. We hope to get to 40 to 50.
And have you even gone down Main Street and asked how many people would actually sign up to be on this list?
I know you guys did the survey.
We did survey. We spent months in the checking the records, looking at how many times.
How many surveys did you send out?
What's that?
How many surveys did you send out?
Oh, you're talking about the income survey? I think we sent 65 income surveys out.
Response?
Of the 30 households that you think would connect to the system, how many of them really would say, yes, we'll get on board with that?
I think it has to be a town decision. It can't ultimately be an individual decision. You either want to protect your groundwater.
If the town spent $130,000 up front, to get this thing started, and then nobody signed up for it, where's our money gone?
That has to be part of it, they have to sign up. There has to be, we need a minimum of 30 people to sign up. It's not gonna work.
Is it possible that you could get a verbal commitment from 30 of these people?
I doubt it.
Why not? Why wouldn't they commit if you said?
So what are you gonna do, take their system, like, eminent domain?
Yeah, you're gonna force them to go onto it?
We have to find 30 people willing to sign up to start with, or we have to force it.
Can we have this vote after we sign the 30 people? Because it's gonna take more than 30 people, it's gonna take the whole town to do this. But could we have to vote after we got 30 people to say, yeah, this is a problem?
It's kind of the chicken and egg problem. If we don't design it and engineer it, then, you know, it's gonna be hard to get an answer. We have to design the system, figure out what it really takes to do this. Right now, our estimate is 1.2. We originally started with 65, to go back a little bit. We were gonna put in two systems. When we finally got this new contractor, Ty and Bond, they thought the economics of going up to Lockheed probably was not favorable. So they came up with this alternative, which is to build one system. The plan would be to go under the river, so we could get Lower Main Street and River Street into one system, and then add 10 or 20 people later on. So the goal would be to get to like 50 houses, which should take care of the majority of the downtown area, which is what our original task was. We weren't tasked with doing the whole town. That's a $20 million problem, or $8 million.
Are you crazy, doing the whole town?
No, I'm just saying, we weren't ever tasked with that. We were trying to salvage the downtown area, which is most at risk. People outside of the town have 1-acre lots or 2-acre lots, so they have a lot of room for all alternative sites. People on Main Street don't have that luxury. They're already within, you know, less than 100 feet from their water supplies.
Yeah.
Joe, can you give us some of the background as to how we got to this point with regards to recommending that, like at one point, wasn't there a
village center
zoning question that went one direction and then it ricocheted back into this because we're talking about, you know, if you want businesses, you know, you have to, can you give some context?
I guess if you want to go all the way back, it started with the new planning board and the idea of creating a village center district so that we could look at the zoning and look more at like mixed use buildings where we would have stores downstairs, maybe apartments upstairs, maybe like Chelsea Falls, you know, where they have apartments upstairs, to look at that kind of zoning. So we did propose a center village. We were also trying to solve the problem of all those lots are non-conforming lots, because when we went to 1-acre zoning, everything in the center of town was non-conforming, and then they all need variances. If we could make them legal lots again, then they don't have to go through the variance process. And variances can be a stumbling block to, you know, development. If people have to go in, and you have to prove hardship. So it's a more difficult road to go. Many towns are trying to get away from using a variance. So you create a downtown village. Most of the towns around here, Deerfield, Shelburne, I'm sure, all have center village districts where the zoning is compatible with what's there. And then you have different zoning outside of the center. The outcome of those meetings was, we can't talk about that till we solve the sewer problem. So we went and formed a sewer commission, a sewer committee, to look at the feasibility of putting in a downtown sewer system. So here we are.
And the sewer committee has been working on this for
3 years. This is our third anniversary coming up.
Right. You know, I think one of the things that may have, you know, in the context of our looking at this was, you know, that we had just probably heard from the schools, you know, with the budget increase for next year, you know, the assessment increase for next year. And, you know, the not at this time, perhaps the not at this time rider, or whatever you want to call it, could be interpreted as a, could we bring this up next year instead or something like that? I don't know, you know, just the in context of the of this year's financial, you know, the budget.
I don't want to muddy the water, but I think putting money in stabilization for projects that we don't know that we're going to do, like a highway garage, maybe this is equally as important, if not more important. So I would challenge you on that aspect as well. I don't know how much your stabilization money is coming out of free cash, but I assume you're not raising and appropriating, you know, stabilization money. But why don't you let them, why don't you raise and appropriate for stabilization and see how many votes you get, you know, instead of making the sewer project go through.
That's a good point.
A loan approach, you know.
Well, stabilization fund benefits the whole town.
This will benefit the whole town if we don't contaminate our water supply. And we tried to make, I mean, the analysis I did, we're talking about $11 on the tax rate, so that's $22 for a $2,000, $200,000.
That's for the 130.
What's that?
That's for the...
No, for the, to build the system. If we get to the, if we put half the cost on the town and half on the users, which is an arbitrary number that I picked, it would cost you $22 a year if you had a $200,000 home. So if we can't come up with $20 a year to save our downtown, we're in a sad state, I think. It's gotta be a community thing.
That sounds a little more rosy than this.
Yeah.
Joe, I have no problem with that. I don't think anybody would have any problem with that, but...
It don't seem real yet.
The problem I have, and me and my wife would be involved with something like this if it come about on River Street, okay? The problem I have is this. Number one is, you want to spend my tax dollars, I can say mine, because we pay through tax bills, on something that you don't know is even ever going to fly. And number two is, if it was going to affect me and my wife at our store, is how much is it going to cost us to get ready for your system, and how much is it going to cost us a year to join your system? And you don't have those figures.
I don't have exact figures because we haven't designed the system. We're asking for money to design a system. I gave you numbers at town meeting, rough numbers. I can give you them again if you want.
And the rough numbers came in at more than we're already paying now to have our plugged out of town.
The average sewer bill in the state of Massachusetts is somewhere around $900 a year. Asheville is $867. I told you they spent $6 to $8 million to take care of the lake. I don't know what else I can tell you. Yes, it's not going to be cheap. It's understandable. We can talk later about how to split the money. We can try to get more grants.
What's the life expectancy of the system?
We're figuring on 30 years. They have some in Pennsylvania that have gone more than that. You know, they're 27 years they dug them up. You know.
I have a question. This is very unfair that a project like this should fall on volunteers who want to do the right thing here. But aren't there any state resources? After all, our water supply is, it's not just ours, it's the state's, it's the Commonwealth's.
Yeah, the state, actually the state owns it.
Okay, well.
You own your well, they own the water in it.
I think you're right. I find it amazing that they're willing to let us and let these towns, Asheville's, whatever they did up there, you know that there have been problems, many, many problems over the years. So I guess what I'm trying to say is, it's even incredible, it's $130,000 to design and engineer this thing. That's like one and a half, two guys working full time for a year to do this. I mean, I don't know where, this, if we could get past this, so we'd get some hard numbers and we could answer questions like what does it cost to hook up, et cetera, I think we'd be in a lot better place. So what, I mean, it just seems like a lot of money for it. It's basically a study to see what, see what
well, it is. This is exactly what's going on here. You've got to have the study done to find out the real numbers.
This is actually final design. We're designing this. The study we did already, the result of the study has been slightly modified, but this is asking for money to design it. The analogy, I guess, would be like you did with the hybrid drive. You went out and had it designed, and then you voted it down. But So we're trying to get it designed, get a final design. There's still questions. We're talking about the, you know, the Rose parcel. We need to dig some holes out there to make sure. We're using old data. We're using the data from the senior housing. We're using the data from 1971 when they dug holes out there for the first sewer system. So we need to validate those numbers before we design the system. But then we would go ahead with a final design. One of the questions is...
So is it a septic system? Not a sewer system.
Right. It's a septic system.
How many? So in the end, Joe, how many bedrooms are going to be in this system? You know, two bedroom, three bedrooms.
Should be roughly 120. One of the things we don't know, going back to the economic development, if you put in a restaurant, that uses up more capacity. If you put in a retail store, it uses less than a house. So we can't make firm predictions on the usage. We don't know if and when there will be any economic development, if you want to throw that into the mix. So for now, we're just assuming...
That almost sounds like the genesis.
We're assuming 33 bedrooms homes, which is 90 bedrooms. We hope to get to 120, 130 bedrooms. But if we have if economic development happens, then it'll change the numbers.
And this is, correct me if I'm wrong, but this is to design a... This is a waste. This is to dispose of the water.
A septic system.
Just to dispose of the water.
We shouldn't call it a septic system, Joe, because all it is a leach field.
Leach field. Okay. It's only a leach field.
With a big D box.
No, you got the D box on your own property.
There's a D box for getting that for you.
No, we're
You got the tight tank on your property.
So what we're going to do, if you have a high quality tank, not a tight tank. Now somebody started a rumor it's tight tank. It's a high quality. If you have a new tank, fairly reasonably put in, we can connect to the outlet of that tank. We will put a filter in your tank, and if you're uphill, you'll go gravity. If you're below grade, you would get a pump installed and it would push it up to the main. The mains are like 3 or 4 inch pipes. They're just put in with a ditch witch. We're not going to dig up the whole center down. We can't. And that would flow to a holding tank. Then it would go through a secondary treatment. It would go through, I showed them at town meeting, but they're modules that take out additional microbial stuff from the water. Then it goes out into a leach field. One of the issues is how big the mound would be. Do we have to put in a 3 foot mound or a 1 foot mound? That's part of what digging holes will tell us, if we have to bring in a lot of fill.
Well, typically just for a single residence is 4 foot above the high water mark.
Well, the data says the water level is 5 feet below grade out there. But we have to confirm that.
So if somebody's house doesn't have a good tank, they're going to have to buy another tank?
You have to replace the tank.
That wouldn't be part of pitching up to it. They'd have to come up with that kind of money.
I think it's kind of in the estimate because it's such a crude number at this point, but that's some of the detail we would have to get. If we haven't gone and dug up everybody's tank. We know approximately how old some of them are. Some are 20 and 30 years old on Main Street. The lower part of Main Street seems to be doing better than the upper part, than the Up River Street, and probably because there's more ledge, there's probably more soil down here. So some of these have gone 20 or 30 years and they seem to have not.
So you have to get the commitment from the people before you, so you could test their tank to see what this whole thing was going to be about, correct? I don't think Joe up the street here is going to let you start digging in his front door yet.
We're not going to do it now, certainly.
No.
But when we get ready to hook him up, right, he might have to do it.
At that point, then he would have to be efficient.
We had talked to the town, we talked to Jan. There's $80,000 in sewer fund, that sewer repair fund. We might be able to use that if we ran into a tank that was failed. You know, concrete was deteriorated. We looked at that as an option to replace the tank.
Joe. How much would 30 waterless toilets cost? The Clivus Motrum from Sweden.
I don't know.
A lot less than that.
Huh? Joe, you're looking.
It's illegal in Massachusetts now. As long as you have a septic system, then you can use the Swedish toilet. But you can't if you don't have a septic system.
Joe, all you're looking for is for a recommendation that's better from the Finance Committee.
That would be nice, yes.
Do you have a change in your recommendation?
I got another question, I'm sorry.
Sure, what's the question?
So town meeting, we did look at this at town meeting. You mentioned that a couple times.
My memory's a little fuzzy. Unfortunately, it was late and people were pretty irritated by then at 10:30.
It was a presentation. And was there, did we have, was there a vote or was it just an informational?
That was our annual report.
Right, okay.
Honestly, for me, it would be so much better if there was some, just even a hypothetical, you know, would you be, if it cost you $1,500 to hook up and $1,000 a year, would you participate in this? I mean, some very conservative number, which to me, those are very conservative numbers, I would think. And if you couldn't get the 30 yeses, then what do you do? Are you saying that the study is what prevented you from doing that? The fact that we don't have a study with
we're trying to do a final design. We're not doing a study, if you will. We're trying to design a system so we can firm up the cost.
Because the thinking is, if you build it, they're going to come. Is that the thinking? You know, like if we have it here, people are going to use it versus doing. I don't know what the realm of thinking is out there. Some of them are going to say, I'll just suffer with what I got because I don't trust your engineering or whatever. I mean, who knows what they're going to say? I don't know.
Well, the Board of Health could condemn the whole center of town. I don't think they're likely to do that.
So. Maybe it's better if the whole center of town got condemned.
What would probably happen, any system that failed would have to get hooked up. That would probably be an outcome of this. Mm-hmm. That would probably be a recommendation when we voted on the final system.
But what you just said there, the whole center of town got condemned. Wouldn't that get some attention from our people in Boston?
No. I would guess not.
Not?
Yeah, it would get their attention. The DEP would come down and say, fix it, guys, and this is what you're going to do.
In general, towns are responsible for their own infrastructure.
Yeah. And bridges.
And bridges, absolutely.
At one time, money was earmarked. You could get money for a sewer system. Those days appear to be gone. Now everybody competes. They're all competitive grants. And Mass Works is one. You can get on the list and see if you can get money.
All right, right now, what we're trying to do, do we have a different recommendation from finance for Jared?
Where did Select Board stand on this one?
We were 2-1.
2-1,
yeah.
What? In favor.
In favor. Who was against? Were you against, Bob? Okay. 2-1. 2-1 on the Select Board. What does finance say? Do you have a different vote?
I don't know. In terms of the environmental, you know, concerns, I'd be willing to reconsider my stance on this one, but you know where you guys are at.
If you want to revote, why don't you make a motion and see where it is?
Well, the financial impact to the town is entirely dependent on the town meeting vote on this one, because the whole amount is now being proposed for borrowing rather than any of it coming from capital.
And what would that be, a year?
Something like that.
I think you said well, 5 years would be like $30,000 a year. Wrong.
Yeah, if we would do it as a 5-year package, it says in here, right?
It'd be 10 cents on the tax rate, I guess.
What do you mean a 5-year package, Tom?
The warrant article itself says that any bonds would have to mature in not more than 5 years from the date of issue. So that's. Instead of going for a 10 or 20 year borrowing period, short-term borrowing.
Short-term.
So where was this design, where are they going to design it? Where's the lease field going to sit?
We're talking about the Rose parcel.
The floodplain down here?
Well, not in the floodplain. But
just out of the ditch?
Just out of the ditch.
Oh, man.
Okay, does finance have another recommendation?
I really don't know what to think. I can keep discussing this with Joel.
Okay. We want to vote from finance as to what the recommendation is.
I would move that we to see if the finance committee will make a yes recommendation on Article 3. Is there a second? There you go.
I'll second it.
Okay, so we got a second. All right. All in favor of recommending Article 3? One. There you go. All opposed?
What's your vote?
Opposed. Abstain.
We've got an opposed and abstain.
Abstain.
And then, so we got, so one yes, two,
one, one, one to two.
Two abstains, and then.
Well, that's better than 0-4.
I guess I should thank you for that.
Thank you, Chuck.
I think it's very short-sighted of everyone here at this table, not to go in favor of this. I think it's a long-term view that has to be taken about the vitality and vibrancy of the downtown. At some point, that's going to fail. And with taking such a short-term view of this, I think it is very unwise to do that. And for a lousy $130,000 to be borrowed, to try to get some viability, some plans that respond to the master plan, by the way, this is in the master plan to do this, I'm just so disappointed that this does not have the support. I'm disappointed because, number one, I'm on the committee. I've been on it for 3 years. But that isn't where the disappointment is. It's that people don't see the value of doing this. And I think the people who are living here 5 years from now are going to really wish that the fathers of this town took some intelligent view of the infrastructure, and this one in particular. So,
thank you, David.
Dave, would you be sure to get up at town meeting and stay just as you did now?
I'm so disappointed that the mentality of this group just doesn't see it. That there's no way that I'm going to convince anybody to change their mind or to look favorably on this. I'm just.
We're hoping you would say the same. Obviously, that's.
Thanks, Dave. All right, let's move on. All right, the next item. We've had a couple of changes to the warrant. I'll make the motion that we accept the warrant with the changes that were made here tonight. Do I have a second?
Second.
All in favor?
Aye.
Okay.
Mr. Chairman, are you done with us?
Joe?
Are you done with us?
You can stay if you want, Dana. If you want to listen to more of our meeting.
My appetite has been completely satisfied.
Okay. Joe, come on up. Joe is going to give us a presentation on the
equipment. Tom had printed these out. Take one of these. Pass those down. Hold on to the line.
Did I admit to you?
Word meeting.
Yeah, well, I did that. Well, once again, my name is Joe Marcari, and I work for FERCOG. I have for almost 3 years now. And my expertise is municipal finance. I was with the Division of Local Services with the state for 15 years, and I ran their technical assistance program, which effectively went out and worked with towns on financial management issues, structural issues, technology, charters, and so forth. And so I've worked in with selectmen, with finance committees, with capital improvement committees, and probably half the 351, cities and towns in the Commonwealth. The Baker administration, Baker-Polito administration, had put up some money and got that approved by the legislature to essentially have consultants like myself work with towns that filed applications to their community compact program. And that was an effort to try and encourage towns to adopt best practices, to do things a little more, differently than they have in the past in a way that they thought was positive. So I've worked with, I think I've got like 17 out of the 26 Franklin County towns in one way or another. And many wanted financial policies developed. Many wanted capital improvement plans developed. One wanted budget documents developed. And what we worked out for Conway was to actually do them all in a long range plan. And at this point, it has culminated in essentially a 130-page document. And I guess what I would say is to envision, there could very well be three different, let's say, binders.
And at the beginning of the budget season, the Board of Selectmen would get their binders, the Capital Improvement Committee would get theirs, and the Finance Committee would get theirs. And these binders are intended to be both as a reference, as a guide, as a historical document to retain historical information from year to year, and as a data source. So it's intended to be your workbook of sorts, and every year it would be updated. This reflects pretty much all that Tom and I had talked about getting into it, and I will say that what's not in here is revenue projections and expenditure projections going out 5 years. I did those. I just threw some numbers at it, just what seemed to make sense. I haven't had a chance to go over the detail with Tom, but quite frankly, it looked too optimistic. It was coming out where your revenues were exceeding the expenditures, and it normally doesn't happen that way. So we need to go over it some more and to make it realistic. But very quickly, going through this, and I'm not going to go through, I think that I brought actually the table of contents. And as a reference, what I've got in here is for all of your recurring revenue sources and your non-recurring revenue sources. This is, you also have to think about this as a public document and something that your residents may find themselves reading. So it's in a sense, it's educational. It should reflect well on everybody here. It should instill some confidence in people that you all know what you're talking about, and you're not making arbitrary decisions, but that you're not making crisis decisions, that you're looking forward and you're trying to do some planning, the same kind of discussion that's really taken place. So it's, in a sense, it's an educational tool. So this starts out with just an explanation in narrative of all of those sources of money that are considered recurring that support your budget. And typically, your line item budget, the omnibus budget that a lot of towns call it, is intended to be all of your recurring expenditures. It's not intended to have one-time expenditures in it. Those expenditures should be in an article, or multiple ones can be in one article in the case of capital. But think of the budget as recurring expenses, and the goal for every town should be set structural balance, where your recurring your recurring expenditures are covered entirely by your recurring revenue. And so you're not using stabilization to fund your operations, because of course stabilization money goes. If it's not replenished, the operational cost continues. You have no money. So it's
what's the state do?
What does the state do?
Yeah.
They do the same thing.
Revenues goes up and down, and they're all jumping around.
Yeah, they're not like the feds. The feds borrow. The feds do borrow money to run operations.
Yeah.
The state can't do it.
Right.
Now, so bond proceeds, for instance, can't be used for operations. And the state does use the rainy day fund, to backfill.
Well, before the big bank fraud, a lot of states were using the capital gains as a regular.
Yeah, they were, and they're trying to get away from that. For the most part, I think Massachusetts has, it's just a better practice if you don't have to tap into those one-time revenues, because it's a good place to get to. So this first section just sort of tries to explain where your recurring revenue can come from. It's really, as I say, it's intended to be educational and reference. And it goes through everything. And then there's non-recurring revenue sources and free cash. What I'll say about free cash is that it's the State Department of Revenue considers it a non-recurring revenue. In practice, most towns use some portion of their free cash for operations, and they just, and as long as you don't overdo it, and as long as you have a mind toward replenishing that free cash, I'm saying, you're going to use it. It's hard not to. But free cash, stabilization, special purpose stabilization funds, special revenue funds. Borrowing, a lot of towns will borrow because they have the capacity within their budget to pay for debt service, so that's borrowing within the levy, that's
not going to the town, asking for a debt exclusion for additional tax dollars. And then borrowing, with a debt exclusion is there, and you all know about that. And there's also capital exclusions, which, if you're not aware, a capital exclusion, let's say you wanted to buy that truck for, I mean, it wasn't a bucket truck, it was some, I forgot what it was. Yeah, say you wanted to float that $20,000, you could, capital exclusion would be put before the voters, and you're essentially saying, we're going to raise your taxes 1 year to raise the $20,000, then next year your taxes go back down to where they were. A lot of towns, particularly on Cape Cod, use a capital exclusion as, in their warrant, as a shopping list. They'll put, they might put 3, 4, 5, 10, or 12 different items and let town meeting choose which ones they want to vote. Of course, then it has to go to townwide vote, and the voters have to choose whether they're going to do that. So it becomes a way of let the voters decide kind of thing on, yeah. But you want to keep it on sort of a lower end costs.
But the Cape's a little different anyways.
Not entirely, no. No, it's not.
There's an awful lot of homes that get taxed and no one's sending the kid to school and they're not there at town meeting.
They have, you know what, they have different kinds of problems that are not unlike what you got out here.
The rates are a lot lower than here.
Well, they've also got a lot more water problems than you do and stuff. And just in terms of water supply, they got... Anyways, I don't want to get into that discussion. But there, a lot of towns do use this on and off the Cape.
I'm sorry, can you clarify what the agenda item, what the discussion, what is the goal here with this tonight? How long is this going to take?
Let me, that's a good question. I've been working on this with Tom for probably, I don't know, since December or so, even before that, probably October. And this is part of the state program, and the intent of the state was to get towns to receive a deliverable, receive a product, accepted through votes of a Board of Selectmen, Finance Committee, and Capital Improvement Committee. And if you do that, then the town would qualify for points toward future grant programs that the state would offer. They haven't specified what grant programs those are, but it's a carrot and a stick kind of thing. So the goal here today was, this is the first time I've been, I think, back before a large group here in this town. Wanted to introduce where we're at. I would like to encourage this group to review what it has in hand and as quickly as feasible to give me comments back through Tom or directly. And then if you think it's something you want to do, to accept it and to do that quickly, sooner rather than later, so that you get on record with the state and you get on that list of towns that have qualified for points. And it also will allow the town to apply sooner for more grant money under this community compact program if there's more to be had and if there's other stuff that you want to do. So
okay, so let me just, yeah, so this would, this we would be establishing, if I'm not mistaken, a set of guidelines, right?
Best practices.
I mean, I flipped through this quickly and many pages of it, it looked like Tom's budget report.
Yes, I was
going to
say that. Yeah, I was going to say that.
So, I mean,
what are your changes in here, though?
Does this...
the way we do business?
This is meant to be updated annually.
Right, okay. So that would be, this would fall on Tom's...
would change.
So this would, the updating would be Tom's responsibility.
I would think.
Okay. Sure.
And is it, this whole program is under the state's community compact program that the... Okay, you know what that is, right?
Well, I just got that from okay. Joe, so
and
yeah.
This is long-range planning, and we're also in the IT section as well. So we have those two areas.
These are public documents. They become public.
Yes.
Every resident has the right to read hold government accountable. If they see something that is different than what's in here, they can question it.
And what they'll see is... What's incorporated here are financial policies. There's quite a few of them, and all of you really have to go over that and those policies to make sure they say what the town wants them to say. We did one session going over those, and I got some feedback. But so there's policies. You know, the town says, "Don't we have any policies?" Yeah. Okay. Now we've got policies.
there's a long-range capital plan. I had received a list of capital or equipment vehicles, things that normally get replaced, and I spoke with all your department heads, or as many as I could reach, about when did you get this, how long do you think it's going to last, when you do have to replace it, what do you think the cost is going to be, and this was all put on a spreadsheet. And so that's in here. So there's 20 years of a capital plan. That's not intended to be my plan. These are all placeholders based on conversations with your department heads. It's what you need to look over and say, nah, that doesn't make any sense at all. And trust me, I have no pride of authorship here. You know, if you were to say we think this is just terrible, then I'm fine with that. This has to be a document that you guys can live with. There's also intended to be here in here, say, 5 years of revenue and expenditure forecast, so that you can look out and get a sense of if we anticipate revenues increasing at a conservative rate, and we look at our expenditures on a very detailed basis, how do they match up going forward? So it's something for people to know that you're looking ahead, you're looking at what your capabilities are going forward, and you're looking for physical events that you have to deal with. And those kind of events should be in here. If you had a consent decree that said you had to do that sewer stuff, then that's got to be built into things. So a capital plan, revenue and expenditure projections, financial policies, some reference stuff, and then a big chunk of it is Tom's budget document, which I will say is very good. Not all town administrators do that. To go through each department and explain what had happened and what they're looking for, what it looks like going forward. So that's a very valuable piece of information to have in here. And his, as you say, that big chunk, that's 40, 50 pages of this thing is Tom's work. So it was not my intent with any of the towns I work with to take what they're comfortable with and what they're using in terms of forms or process and change it. I try to incorporate all of that, because if it's working for you, why am I going to? I'm not going to try and convince you to change it. It makes no sense. Also in here is your bylaws, and I don't recall whether we put guidelines in here, thinking in terms of new members to your committees. It's something that they can get through and educate themselves on what your task is, your role is, what your process is, what, you know, when they say, well, what do we do? Well, this will be in here. This is what we do as a committee. It's all intended to be informative. So that's really the long and the short of it. And as I said, my hope is that it's something that you'll now have, and over the course of whatever time period makes sense for you, to look through it, pass along comments. As I said, everything. I mean, this has to be something that you think is going to be valuable for you, and it's got to say what you want to say, not what I wanted to say. So that's where I'm at.
Great. Thank you, Joe. Obviously, you know, we've met a number of times, and Joe has done a lot of work on this. Joe is an expert at these types of things, and I'm sure that there's plenty of information in here that will be very good for us to follow in terms of policy and procedure. Any questions for Joe?
Joe, Do you have any experience with how towns budget for the versus local schools, how they handle the benefits cost for the school employees?
Most towns, it's a sort of a hidden school cost. Most towns, the town side carries the benefit cost. You've got one line item for healthcare costs, or one line item for whatever other benefits are there, and usually it's on the town side. If you borrow for a school project, usually that's on the town side. So the towns, it's a little bit of, in most town budgets, those who have full school systems, K through 12, 50% of their budget is on the school side. Except if you add in the borrowing cost, if you add in the benefits, it probably jumps to like 65 or 70% of the budget. So yes. it's a hidden cost that the town's carrying for the schools.
The schools actually account for those amounts when they have to file their A-19, I think it is, in October. They have to pay with the DESC. They have to file every year this form that talks about enrollments and other their costs, and it has to do with their reimbursement. And they do account for that money when they're reporting to the state, but, you know, when you're looking at it locally, those costs are on the town side. Almost, I've never really seen it.
Why? Why is that?
You know, I don't know. Maybe it's just history, habit.
Is there some regulation that requires that to be?
No.
From DESE that says that the benefits shall be carried on the town?
No, there isn't. It may be that there's a lot of turnover a lot in schools, and there's a lot of movement, and a lot of times the schools have trouble keeping up with people who come on, go off, and with the part-time people and so forth. Maybe it stemmed from the paperwork. I don't know. Only one bill comes to the town. The schools don't get a separate bill for their health insurance, for instance. The town gets it for the entire town. You know, do you want to charge the school department for that? You know, it's all stuff on paper. Yeah, it's all the town's money.
I think the point is to make it transparent.
Yeah, and then you run into, well, what about all the other departments? Are we going to make it transparent for all the other departments? And when you start doing that, then you start talking about, well, are we going to separate our phone bills? Are we going to separate our heating bills? Are we going to separate our oil bills? It gets a little tedious.
I was going to ask you, what are the towns, how are we here? Long-range planning for the declining enrollment in the schools.
I don't think anyone's doing any long-range planning. I think they're all operating on a crisis basis with that. I mean, Heath is the most recent one. You know, they closed down their school, and I think they're going to Rowe, but I don't know that for sure.
The votes at the town meeting coming up.
Yeah. So there are schools, towns in that situation. And part of this is to address that whole crisis situation.
Well, actually, I was thinking, they say this town, 7 kids from the town were in the kindergarten coming up. Well, that's not too many.
No, not enough to support a school.
What we're going to look to do is to review this for about 3 weeks and approve it in about 6 weeks. So any comments that anybody has on Joe's work here,
let us know in
3 weeks.
So you said there's a piece of this that is more aimed at the selectmen and a piece aimed at the finance committee?
I guess the way I would say it is that if the capital improvement committee is going through its tasks, it's not necessary for all the capital requests to be in the folder that the selectmen receive, for instance. And I will, because I have in the past at public, I will speak to that issue. I think it's very important that you do come to some decision on how your committees are going to operate, in that what autonomy are they going to have, and what's going to be the courtesy or the practice. If your capital improvement committee goes through an entire process to try and come up with priorities, or your finance committee goes through an entire process to come up with recommendations, you know, to what extent are you going to allow those to be altered by another group that's reviewing them? If you're going to do that,
town meeting.
Town meeting can.
And
in fact, the finance committee, technically, anything to do with money, technically can reverse, I suppose you could say, a capital improvement committee recommendation. But I think in terms of protocol and courtesies, if you want people to serve on your committees, then there has to be some understanding that my preference with capital improvement committees is that they make their recommendations, and that the finance committee or the board of selectmen should adopt or reject in the entirety, and not pick and choose stuff. And if the board of selectmen or the finance committee has a problem with one of the recommendations, then it comes up. Then they should voice that at town meeting. But it, that's just my preference.
But with respect to this document, is there a piece that the capital improvements committee should concentrate on, or a piece that the selectmen should concentrate or that the finance committee should concentrate on?
I would certainly say walk your way through it, and I think it'll become self-evident what parts would be. The capital improvement plans that I've done so far have included the discussions about funding sources, the historical data, the financial policies that relate to capital, any kind of bylaw or policy on capital, has included the entire capital plan, the spreadsheets for all the capital plan, and in the back, as it has, the binders have included section labels for each department. And so tucked into those labels would be each department's recommendation or request for that year. And so that it's their document that they can see and just go right to it, and then in the following year, those get replaced with the newer requests for the, so those I wouldn't see necessarily having to follow everybody. Mm-hmm. The finance committee is going to get maybe some revenue and expenditure projections. Capital improvement committee doesn't need the revenue and expenditure projections. Thank you, Joe. You have a question?
Yeah, while he's here, could you briefly elaborate on OPEB? Well, let me just tell you what my understanding is, and you correct me.
It's all in here.
Well, in here it says there's a separation between basically health care versus pension. And if I read this, as you wrote, which corresponds to the definition I actually saw on Wikipedia, that pension is not part of OPEB.
No.
It's just healthcare benefits that we're asked to stabilize or have basically a fund for.
Yeah, it's everything other than pension. So it could be dental, it could be vision, it could actually be non-health. I don't know if those benefits exist, but it could be non-health. It's just not pension.
Okay.
And what the White Tower guys up at Gatsby want to see towns funding their OPEB liability, because it is a forward-looking liability, the same way that they're required to fund their pensions. I think that most towns don't have, in the east part of the state, it's millions and tens of millions of dollars. Out here in the west, it's a lot less, and it might be more achievable to fund that. But it's if you're looking to borrow, the credit rating agencies will look favorably on if you have an OPEB policy, if you have an OPEB trust set up, and they want a trust under there's a general statute that authorizes the setting up of a trust, because it has to be irrevocable. Once the money goes in, you can't get it out except for OPEB purposes. So that's why stabilization funds don't work.
Great,
thank you,
Joe.
Thank you very much. Yep. All right. Do we have your contact information if they want to contact you directly?
Would you mind circulating that?
I will do that.
Okay, I'm happy to take calls from anyway.
All right, see you later, turn. All right, next item on the agenda, concerns of the selection. Any concerns?
No. I got two.
Two?
No.
Okay, Bob, what are your concerns? Okay.
Thank you.
Tony Boyd met with me today. I've been in down the street. And we have a town, old, many, many, many hundreds of years ago, old town pond, which is an area that was set up zillions of years ago. It's an old white stone wall, it's very small, probably not much bigger than these table circumferences here. And it's on Old Cricket Hill Road, just above Tim Morgan's driveway, on the right-hand side. And he looked it up today, he's concerned with our 250th come up. And he looked up today to find out that the town does own the pond. And he would like to go in there, if you would give him permission, and clear all the brush and debris out of it.
It's a pound.
They used to call pound years ago.
Stray animals.
They used to put in years ago.
A pound.
Pound.
Okay.
It's a building. It's a lot.
No, it's just a stone wall opening.
Oh, they put a stray cow in there.
When a stray cow, they didn't know who belonged to. They put in the pound, and somebody come to get it.
Uh-huh.
Okay. Or any other animal.
Okay. Yeah.
Because this is an artifact of the town of Conway, he would like to make it look better before the 25th comes up. And even possibly maybe even put a sign on it, just to stay in what it does.
Oh.
Or what it was for.
Mm-hmm.
So he asked if I would ask the Board of Selectmen if he, we would give permission that he could go in there and clean up. He'd like to do it all on his own.
You see the problem with that?
I don't.
How could you say no?
How could you refuse it? Huh?
Okay. All right.
So I'd like to make a motion. Make a motion that we allow Tony Borton to do that.
I'll second.
All in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Thank you. Thank you. One more item. I got to change hats now.
Okay.
The last one, I promise, John.
Okay.
I'll put my fire department hat on. Okay. I want to make the town aware and give you due notice that, and then hope Tom will relate us to our town treasurer. That next month we're going to be having, looks like right now the next month is the month we're going to have to be paying for our fire truck when it will be delivered. It's getting real close. I got pictures today of it, and the guy's out, he's out of the factory taking pictures of it. I got him at 6 o'clock this morning, pictures. And it looks like in the next 3 to 4 weeks, I'm going to, at least probably 2 weeks, maybe even sooner than that, we'll be going out there to inspect it. And hopefully that by the end of May, or the first week in June the latest, we'll be having to pay for it when it's still in town coming. So just if you were to alert her for that, Tom.
Sure.
I know she has borrowing or has done borrowing. I don't know how she for that.
Yeah.
And when we get within the 2 week length, I shouldn't say within, we get up almost to the 2 weeks of delivery, I will have the proposal put in for the town warrant.
What's the expected delivery date?
We don't have that at this point, right yet. Okay, but we're all thinking it's probably going to be next month, toward the end of next month.
Great.
So,
great.
Okay. And we're expected to pay for it?
Yeah, when it does. We didn't pay a dime yet. So they're probably getting a little nervous now.
Okay. Great. Thank you, Bob.
Thank you.
That's great.
Let's see.
We'll be here for the donor. What do we get?
We hope.
Yeah.
Yes, this is the oil spill that happened right near the town office across the street. There has been certified as finally having been cleaned up.
Oh, the old Jermaine garage property.
It was two doors down from the town office. Remember, there was an oil spill in the basement. That's the one.
Oh, no, that's it's one at the same time the town office.
Yeah, so it's across the street.
No, it's directly on the same side as the town office.
Yeah, across the street from the
landing property. Yep.
So that's been certified as having been cleaned up.
That's good. Mm. That's great. They probably didn't put down the price, did they?
I bet that was unfortunate.
And it's just, if you see helicopters, they're going to be cleaning up the lines.
Going to be cleaning up the lines.
A blue and white helicopter will be flying around town.
I saw one of those. Where did I see one of those?
Is that our high tension lines or what are they on?
Yeah.
On Strickshire?
Yeah, Western Mass Transmission Lines. Tuesday the 11th, Wednesday the 12th. They're going to be flying around. Okay.
Let's be very careful.
Yeah, we don't want them to crash. That's very dangerous when they do that, too.
It is. And we got, where did this come from?
The cog.
The comp.
Okay. It was handed out at the...
Did you guys see that? Okay. Okay, we have any other announcements? No? All right, our next meeting is scheduled for Tuesday. That's next Tuesday, the 18th. Because Monday is Patriots Day. It's a day off here in Massachusetts. So our next meeting is Tuesday the 18th in the town office at 6 p.m. Okay, if there's no other business to come before the board, I'll make a motion to adjourn. Do I have a second?
Second.
All in favor?
Aye.
Okay.